now we're going to, after Dr. Peter Kreeft's wonderful talk, we're going to get a little dose of Peter Kreeft, because we're going to watch a play based on his book, Socrates Meets Jesus. And to introduce it, the man who is staging it tonight, the one, the only, the producer and manager of Theater of the Word Incorporated, Kevin O'Brien!
Oh, nobody's here. Oh, man. Oh. The show is only about an hour long, maybe an hour and 15 minutes, based on the book by Peter Kreeft. I had to deal with the publisher of this book, InterVarsity Press, because apparently as the author, he has no say in what is done with his work. So I dealt with InterVarsity Press. They gave me the rights to adapt it for the stage, which I've done. We also have been given the rights to film it, but I have a five-year window to get that done. We're in about year two of that. Anyway, I've talked enough. I think you're really going to like the show. Stick around. Put your hands together for Socrates Meets Jesus.
Hi, Tom.
Oh, hey, Molly. How's it going?
How was
your vacation?
Oh, my vacation. Well, I went home and I spent Christmas with the family.
Yeah? How was that?
Oh, Christmas I love. Family I tolerate.
Yeah, right? My mom and dad are always at each other. She's always finishing his sentences for him, never lets him speak. Guess that's true love.
So, what did you do during break? I mean, where did you go?
Nothing. Nowhere.
Nowhere. You said you were going to call.
Oh, gosh, so Molly, it was one time. It was a party. I was drunk. It doesn't mean I'm interested in you.
Well, you made me believe that you were...
No, listen. So if I want to spend winter solstice alone, I spend it alone.
But I thought you
no,
were
No, you didn't think. That's the problem with everyone here. Nobody thinks. Philosophy. Religion. $40,000 a year is costing me. And for what? I know less now than when I started.
Wait a minute. Costing you?
Well, my parents. But that doesn't obligate me to spend winter break with them any more than an innocent hookup obligates me to spend it with you.
Look, Tom, you can call what happened hooking up.
Yeah.
But it wasn't that. We talked. We got to know one another as friends. At least that's what I thought.
Molly, we can't be friends.
And why not?
Well, for one thing, I'm not a very friendly guy. And for another thing, you're not really known for having the best taste in friends.
What do you mean?
Oh, gosh, Molly, they're all over the place. Socias, emos, jocks. There's no rhyme or reason to any of them.
Well, then you should fit right in.
Ha. Huh. You don't know the first thing about me. I'm a serious thinker. I'm a Marxist. I'm a deconstructionist, a Freudian, and a skeptic.
I'm okay with that.
And I'm certainly not in Christology class because I believe in God.
I'm okay with that, too.
You're okay with everything.
Look, I'm a good person. I tolerate everyone. I'm okay with all things, all ways.
Are you okay with the fact that I'm not a guy who's twice your age, walks around in a toga, and telling everyone he's Socrates?
Oh, Tom, come on.
Look, Molly, it's a pickup line that's gone too far. He only wants one thing from you, and the fact that you spend as much time with him as you do.
Ah, hello, Thomas.
Hey, what's up, Prof?
Glad to see you signed up for this class. And you are?
I'm Molly Cottle, and I'm really looking forward to this class.
Yes, Miss Cottle, but we're lucky the course didn't get canceled. Only 3 students is awfully small. Still, this is a graduate-level seminar, and while on the one hand the administration was unwilling to go forward, on the other they realized the importance of intimate discussion. Yes, it was a true dilemma, and they were hovering between the horns thereof, unsure of whether to cancel the course or let it run. Until I broke the stalemate.
How?
I offered to reduce my rate. They're giving me a third of what I usually get.
A true sacrifice for the sake of knowledge. Say, do you think they'd be willing to reduce my tuition by the same amount?
This is Christology 500, Thomas, not science fiction.
Well, I've heard nothing but good things about you and about this course, Doctor.
Why, thank you, Miss Cottle. And let me just say I'm looking forward to teaching you. Let me correct that. To facilitating you. to facilitating the discussion between yourself, myself, Thomas here, and our third student.
And who's that?
Well,
it's someone I've never heard of before. His name's Socrates.
You've never heard of Socrates?
Well, of course I've heard of Socrates, but this student, whoever he is, correction, he or she is, this student has no first name, this student has no first initial, this student has no known address.
This student has no clue.
What do you mean?
All right, look, so the end of last semester, this guy shows up on campus wearing a toga telling everyone he's Socrates. Doesn't know where he is or how he got here. Last thing he remembers is drinking the hemlock and falling asleep.
I see.
Yeah, so then he starts making friends with some of the students, right? Like Molly here. Starts sitting in on lectures and peppering the students with questions, and the instructors too. First, I thought he was, you know, one of those homeless guys who show up to the faculty receptions for the free finger food. But this guy plays the part of the hilt, and some people think...
Some people think he would be a good addition to this class.
Really? Yeah. Why is that?
Well, when I first met Socrates, he was wandering around like he was really crazy.
Which he is.
He said he couldn't get a handle on things like cars whizzing by and planes roaring overhead. He said he didn't have things like that in his day. So I played along and I said, well, of course not, Socrates. This is the modern world. This is progress. And then he asked me to define my term.
To define progress?
He's always doing that. He's always asking people questions and making them think.
It's called the Socratic method.
So I said that progress is constantly moving forward. And he said, toward what? And I said, it's the journey that matters, not the destination.
Very good.
Well, he wasn't satisfied.
Oh.
He said that if progress were good and if progress meant advancement, then we must be advancing toward the better. And I said, we have. I told him that compared to his day, these days were a lot better. Why, we have control over nature. We've cured most diseases. We have central heating and air conditioning and television and telephones.
What did he say to that?
Well, then he says, if you progress to the better, people must be happier now than they were in my day.
Hmm.
And I said, well, I think so, but I'm not ethnocentric. I don't think it's possible to compare two cultures.
Excellent, Molly. You make a wonderful student. That's a wise thing to say.
Actually, he said it was foolish. He said one could indeed compare cultures and compare them on the basis of whether man was happier or not. He said, for example, compared to my day, is there more or less discontent expressed in your literature? Are there fewer and smaller wars or greater and larger wars? Are there fewer people leaving their jobs, their homes, their wives, their lives, their husbands out of discontent or more? And I had to admit there was actually more of all these things, and he found it impossible to believe.
So this so-called Socrates doesn't seem to think much of progress, eh?
Progress is the modern god, Professor, and Socrates is knocking it. Maybe I was wrong about this guy. I think I'm going to like him after all. Seems like an iconoclast.
Well, he certainly seems like he'll be interesting.
Oh, he's not just interesting. He's Socrates.
What do you mean?
I mean, he really believes that he's Socrates. If you ever wondered what Socrates would say or do in any given situation, just ask this guy.
Well, then we have the perfect opportunity.
The perfect opportunity for what?
To burn down the church and bury it. To apply logic and reason to myth and fable. To watch the world's greatest thinker tear to shreds the age-old lie. I mean, that's what this course is about, right, Professor? Debunking the Christ myth? Jolting our minds awake from the opiate of the masses, right?
Thomas, the purpose of this class is to explore the Christ event.
Oh, well, it's going to be more than that. We're going to find out what happens when Socrates meets Jesus. Boom!
What do you mean?
Well, Socrates was the greatest thinker of the ancient world, right?
Yeah.
And he died 400 years before Jesus was born, right?
Yeah.
So, if the real Jesus ever met the real Socrates, well, speak of the devil.
Oh, the devil? Oh, I thought this was a class on the person called Christ. Perhaps I'm in the wrong room.
This guy.
Socrates. My name is Dr. Nuance, and this is Christology 500. Oh. I believe you already know Miss Molly Coddle.
Yes, Molly.
Socrates? And this is Mr. Tommy Skeptic.
Socrates, my man. Boom.
Professor.
Before we get started, I'm curious about one thing. Due to the advanced nature of our discussions, admission to this class is by permission of the instructor. And yet, I do not remember signing off on your registration. Not that I don't welcome you here.
Well, forgive me, Professor, but I have no knowledge of the intricacies of this beast you call registration. All I know is the gods have sent me here.
The gods?
Or the God. That is what I'm trying to find out. Is God one, as you believe and as I suspected many years ago, or is he many, as my fellow Greeks or pagans, as you call them, believe?
Oh, that's right. You drank the hemlock, went to sleep, and woke up on the campus of Habit Divinity School 2.5 millennia later.
Yes, with my student ID in place and course registration complete.
Registration without standing in line? That's the real miracle. Taking classes without paying a fortune? That's more miraculous than your resurrection. Or his.
Whose?
Oh, well, the Christ event is the Christ event is the primary subject in which we study in this class, didn't you know? It's a central element, yes, of Christianity.
The Christ event?
The Christ event, yes.
And the resurrection?
The resurrection from the dead, yes. It's the central element of the resurrection event, yes.
Why are you doing that with your fingers?
It indicates quotation marks, or in Anglo parlance, inverted commas. Yes, a punctuation device used to indicate that we're using terms.
What do you mean by terms?
Words.
Well, is it not obvious that we're using words?
Yes, but some words are merely terms and do not connote anything valid beyond themselves.
Professor, if there are words that do not connote reality, why on earth would you use them?
Must you question everything?
Yes.
That's right, I forgot. You're, Socrates. Very well. I'll play along. You are the world's greatest philosopher, after all, and, well, it's a pleasure to have a philosopher in this class.
Professor, you seem a bit uncomfortable with philosophers. Tell me, have you no philosophers at this school?
Yes, we have philosophers here.
Where are they?
In the philosophy department.
Philosophy is not a department.
Nonetheless, we have philosophers here.
Are they dangerous?
Of course not.
Well, then they are not true philosophers.
Zing! Score one for the ancient Greek. Yeah, man, I had to totally get out of that department. It used to be my major. I had to switch it. My dad almost killed me. I had 3 years to my studies. Cost him a fortune. But, you know, I had to get out of there, right? Philosophy, what a waste of time.
Right? Young man, how can you say that? The unexamined life is not worth living.
A quote from the Apology of Socrates. Very good. You know your material.
The Apology, the speech you gave that was recorded by your pupil Plato, that you said it when you were tried and condemned in 399 BC. I just happened to have printed a copy of it off the internet.
You just said that word again, that phrase, BC. I've heard that quite a bit here. What does that mean?
Well, that's how we mark our calendars. BC meaning before Christ, and AD or Anno Domini in the year of our Lord or after Christ.
Do you mean to tell me that you measure all the years of your history as either preceding or following the life of this one man?
Yes, but here at the School of Divinity, we use BCE, before the Common Era, and CE, Common Era, Common.
But either way, Christ divides your eras.
Mm.
It seems to me that this one historical figure is the benchmark of all human history.
This is not a seminar on the historical Christ. This is a seminar on the Christ event. What people have made of a figure's historicity is beside the point.
How on earth, Professor, can any man's historicity be beside the point?
Perhaps you are not prepared to take a class at this level, sir. Perhaps you have not completed the prerequisites. Did you take demythologizing scripture? Hmm? Did you take comparative religion? For goodness sake, did you take logic?
Take it, I gave it to the world. Now, I admit that I have not yet studied your scripture, nor have I attempted to demythologize them, whatever that means, but I did sit in on one class session of comparative religion with Molly here.
Ah, now did that go?
The professor asked him to leave.
Really? I'm not surprised.
You see, the professor gave an astonishing lecture on the world's religions, and when he was finished, he made the amazing claim that all religions are the same. And so I simply pointed out to him that that claim was contradicted by the content of his lecture.
In what way?
Well, if all religions were the same, they would all be equally true or right. Whereas, of course, it is obvious that nearly all religions are wrong or false.
My sentiments exactly.
If atheism is right,
which it is,
and there are no gods,
exactly.
If that's true, then
yeah,
all religions are wrong. And of course, if atheism is wrong,
no,
then there are either many gods or one god. And if there is only one god, then all polytheistic religions are wrong. And then if there is only one God, there's the question of this character, Christ. If he was indeed the Messiah, or the Son of God, whatever that means, well then, the Christian religion is right, and the Jewish and Muslim faiths are wrong. I mean, it's really quite simple. I don't see how you can fail to see it. All religions are not the same, nor do they make the same claims about God or the nature of reality. For instance, according to the professor's lecture, Buddhism teaches that the world is an illusion and that suffering is pointless. And from what little I understand of your Christian faith, you believe the world is very real indeed and that suffering can somehow be good. Now, all of these religions may indeed be wrong, or one of them may be right, but they cannot all be right, nor are they all the same.
I can see why you frustrated the professors. Molly, how did your professor respond to this?
Well, he didn't, but I did.
Hmm?
I told Socrates that religion isn't about the truth, it's about feelings.
Hmm.
I mean, it's like art. It's silly to argue over which art form is the truth and which one is the best.
Or like politics. You know, different political systems work for different cultures in different places and different times. There's no one that's better than the rest except for communistic socialism, which is clearly the ideal. Democracy worked for the ancient Greeks, but it doesn't work for us unless Republicans lose elections.
How long have you been here?
8 years, 320,000 and counting.
Okay. Socrates, I think what both of our young friends are trying to say is that all religions are equal in that they are all faltering human attempts at the divine. Thus, they are all relative.
But is religion a human thing?
What?
Well, is it like art or politics a human thing?
It's the most important human thing. It's at the heart of human life.
Its dwelling place is human, certainly, but its origin, is that human or divine? Was it divine?
Ah, the baptism of John. Is it of heaven or of men? This is the question Jesus posed to the Pharisees. They wiggled out of it. I'm beginning to like your method, Socrates. Let's see if you can do better than the Pharisees did and answer it. Class, what is the origin of religion? Is it human or divine?
It's human.
All religions are equally true, equally beautiful, and equally human.
Molly,
If
that's the case, what do you make of the three world religions that claim to have been invented by God? Islam, Judaism, and Christianity all claim to have been invented by God.
Well, wait a second. He didn't just sit in on comparative religions. He read the textbook. Cool it, Toga Boy. You're making us grad students look bad.
Yes. Am I right? Do these three world religions make this claim?
They do.
And apparently you disagree with this claim.
To be divine revelation rather than human? I guess I do.
All right, then. So why do you call yourself a Christian?
Really, Socrates, I cannot believe you would stoop to a level of personal attack like that.
Sensitive girl, yeah.
Well, I meant no personal attack, only accurate description.
Look, you are a very nice person, Socrates, but you're being just a little judgmental right now.
No, Molly, I'm trying to use my judgment to determine what this Christianity is, what it means to be a Christian, and who Jesus Christ was.
Well, I firmly believe that it is imperialistic and arrogant to impress your religion on other people and to insist that your way is the only way.
All right, I understand. Now, Molly, if that's the way you believe and feel and think, then therefore, since you're a Christian, Jesus Christ must have taught that as well, correct?
Actually, he said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me.
Well then, Molly, according to your own definition, Jesus Christ must have been very imperialistic and arrogant.
No, on the contrary, nothing made him angrier than the arrogance and bigotry of religious leaders. No man in the history of the world was more meek, more compassionate to everyone. I just have problems squaring his statements of exclusivity versus his statements of inclusivity.
Which, in fact, is what this class is all about. To explore how we feel about Jesus. How we handle the Christ meme in our own minds.
Yes, Professor, I am less interested in my own mind than what it tells me about the truth.
An admirable sentiment, but after all, Socrates, what is truth?
Quid est veritas? Pontius Pilate's own words, like Socrates, Professor, you too know your material.
Well, Thomas, the question remains, and is the central question of postmodern thought. What is truth? Now, I posit that truth is entirely subjective. It is what we ourselves make of it. In short, there is no truth.
You're serious. Well, certainly your statement contradicts itself.
In what way?
Well, you're claiming that the statement there is no truth is true, which cannot be so if there is no truth. If there is no truth, nothing can be true, and nothing is worth saying. We might as well stop asking questions, stop talking, stop answering questions, stop going to school.
Oh, I second that motion. Recess, anybody? Anybody? Bueller? It's a movie from the 80s. Doesn't matter. It's okay.
Well, you do make a good point.
Look, Socrates, I still think you're a crazy nut job, but I'm beginning to admire your guts. You speak power to authority, dude. Boom.
That's one of the reasons they killed me. Boom, you see? I learned a valuable lesson. You cannot crusade for the truth and expect to survive.
That's why they crucified Jesus.
Which is what this class is supposed to be about. And yet, we have here a man who claims to know nothing of who the Jesus figure was. Nor does he come to us bowed and crippled with the baggage of church intolerance and persecution. He claims to know neither Jesus nor what the institution called church made of Jesus. Class, new exercise. I suggest we begin to tell him.
Thank you, Professor.
I'm okay with that.
Oh, that would be very helpful to me. I'll ask the questions. They can answer them.
By all means.
Marvelous. Let's begin with this. Okay. What did Jesus teach?
Unity, love, liberation, salvation, and tolerance.
In short, superstition.
That's a critique of his teaching, Thomas, not a synopsis. Let's try this. Is there any one thing that Jesus stood for above everything else?
Love.
Love.
Mm-hmm.
Would you agree with that, Thomas?
What is love?
Really, Thomas? That's almost as stupid as what is truth.
All right, don't get personal. Yes, I would agree with Molly that the central focus of Christ's teaching was before it got corrupted and twisted by the white patriarchal capitalists of the Catholic Church. Love.
The central message is love.
Yeah.
And that's it.
What do you mean that's it?
Well, I would have thought that anyone with even a little wisdom would have recognized the greatness of love. Is this what makes Jesus, the founder of your faith, the center of your history? But do we not all root for love? Do we know anyone who says, let's hear it for hate?
But he was more radical than anyone else.
What do you mean by that?
In the way of love.
But what do you mean by radical?
As I was just telling you, he was more radical in the way of love.
Well, explain that.
All right. He taught us that we should love even our enemies.
So did I.
He was killed for his teaching.
So was I.
He liberated people from prejudice, ignorance, and sexism.
So did I.
He taught a high monotheism.
So did I.
An ethical idealism.
So did I.
He told people of life after death.
So did I.
He was a prophet. He was a servant of God.
So was I.
Are you saying that you're as great as him? Not that I'm being judgmental. I'm okay with that.
No, how absurd for me to say that all history should be based upon my life. That would be ridiculous. Everything after Socrates would be A.S. Everything before Socrates, B.S.
I want to not say that.
What I'm trying to find out...
Yes?
...is what makes Jesus better than I am, or better than anyone else?
Well...
He claimed he was God.
What was that?
He claimed to be God.
A God, you mean?
No, the God. The one and only true God, made man... Walking around on earth, performing miracles, feeding the hungry, healing the sick, raising the dead, preaching, teaching, the whole nine yards. You got it.
Astonishing. He claimed this once?
More than once. I and the Father are one. He who has seen me has seen the Father. Before Abraham was, I am. It was the central teaching of the Christian faith that Jesus Christ was both God and man has been believed and professed in all the creeds, saints and sinners alike, throughout history.
Thomas.
Yeah.
Do you believe this claim? Do you believe Jesus was God?
No. There is no God. Jesus was just a good teacher, a wise and caring man.
Well, good heavens, Thomas. It's the only thing he could not have been.
Why not?
Well, anyone who would claim to be God must be anything but a wise man. In fact, he might be very seriously insane, or a liar, or a fool. Jesus must have been either a liar, a fool, a madman, or God. The only thing he could not have been was a mere wise man.
Ah, Socrates. Here is where your unfamiliarity with the modern philosophical awareness of limitations of language come into play. You see, there is another option. Christ could have meant something very fine, subtle and ethereal by the term God.
What do you suppose he meant?
Well, most scholars think, those that have studied the proper
text... Oh, cut the claptrap nuance. Come on, he was a first century Jew talking to other first century Jews. He meant the God of the Jews, the God of his people.
What sort of God was the God of the Jews?
Well, to know that, you'd have to read the Hebrew Scriptures. Here now, I have a reading list that includes dozens of articles and websites by scholars who've actually read the Scriptures. If you read these by our next session and discuss, we will take time to discuss
Professor, this is a list of things that have been written and published within the last 5 years.
And a lot of it, too. Well, you don't want us to read all this, do you?
You get double. Yes, the most up-to-date scholarship.
But couldn't we get closer to the source, or to the source itself? Couldn't we simply read the Hebrew Scriptures rather than what the modern scholars make of the Hebrew Scriptures?
The canon of Hebrew Scripture is rather extensive.
He means the Old Testament is more than 1,000 pages long.
Well, we have a week until our next session, don't we? I shall read the books of the Old Testament and return in 7 days to discuss them with you. How thrilling, Professor!
Well, call me a slacker, but I'm not reading the Old Testament. I got a lot of stuff to do. This Ultimate Frisbee thing that I got to, and there's other important things I got to. I'll maybe look at a couple of these. Call me a slacker, but sorry.
You're a slacker. See you next week.
Well, slacker, here you go. Here's something you probably haven't read since your philosophy days.
What's this?
The Apology of Socrates, the speech he gave to his accusers before he was sent to his death.
I've read this already.
Yeah, well, apparently I read the Bible, and I have to do it again. I'll see you next week, slacker.
Living or dead, to a good man there can come no harm. Nor are his affairs a matter of indifference to the gods. That is why I am not very bitter at those who voted to condemn me, nor at my accusers. But one thing I beg of you, gentlemen. When my sons grow up, I beg you to punish them. If they seem to you to care for money, or if they care for anything else more than they care for virtue. And now the time has come for our departure. I to die, and you to live. Which of us goes to meet the better lot is hidden from all, unless it be known to God.
Hi, Tom.
Oh, hey, Molly, how you doing?
How was your week?
Good. Yeah, I spent some time with Socrates.
Oh, by reading Plato?
No, with that dude, Socrates.
You spent time with him?
Yeah, we spent time talking about the New Testament.
You mean the Old Testament, right?
No, the New Testament. He read them both.
He read the whole Bible in a week?
Right? Kind of makes his grad students look bad, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, he read the Old Testament. He was so on fire, he just had to keep going through the Gospels, the Epistles, all the way to Revelation in the end. Boom, done.
What did he think?
Say he's a new man.
A new man.
Born again. Oh. Hey, look, Molly, I sort of maybe owe you an apology for last week. I was sort of rude to you, and I've been meaning to call you since before Christmas. And
good morning, Thomas. Good morning, Molly.
Good morning, Doctor.
So, where's our man without pants, huh? Couldn't take the heat, could he? Had to get out of the kitchen, did he? I'll bet when he began to read the Hebrew scriptures, he...
Professor, Molly, Thomas.
Socrates.
I have one question for the people in this room.
What? Did you read your assignment?
He read the whole Bible.
The whole thing?
I have only one question for the people in this room. In fact, I have only one question for the people in this university. In fact, I have only one question for the people in this universe.
Only one. That surprises me. Well, out with it. What is it?
Well, my question's a bit embarrassing, but I'll ask it anyway. Where are the Christians?
I'm sorry?
Where are the Christians?
What are you talking about? They're all over the place.
This place?
Yes, this place and many other places, too.
Well, then there is something I do not understand.
And what is that?
Well, if all of you are Christians, if...
Oh, I'm not.
Well, if some of you, if any of you are Christians, how can you still live the way you do? How can the born child so closely resemble the unborn child? How can your lives be so dull if this incredible book is true?
Socrates, are you putting us down?
Alas, Molly, I was afraid that's what you would think. I've only discovered this Christianity thing within the last few days myself. Far be it from me to tell you or anyone else what it amounts to, but this book, This book tells us what it amounts to. And if everything in this book is right, what it amounts to, compared with everything I've ever known, is a whale compared to minnows.
Socrates, it's nice of you to get so excited about the Bible.
Nice? Did you say nice?
Oh, now, Socrates, don't be so negative. We're very happy for you if you found happiness.
Molly, even happiness is hardly mentioned in that book, but rather joy. Do you even know the difference? Have you even read the New Testament?
Well, of course.
Well, perhaps you of coursed it. Is that what it means to take a course here?
Now, just a moment. Exactly what do you find missing in this course, and apparently in the lives of most so-called Christians?
Well, I'll try to explain it. I'll begin with the Hebrew scriptures first.
Very well.
When I read them, I was not entirely surprised at the Hebrew notion that there was only one God or that he had a name. All of my life, I tried to name God, although I never would.
Well, why not?
Well, because I could not, in honesty.
Well, that honesty was deadly for you.
What do you mean, Thomas?
Well, it's all right here in your apology, which I read a couple of times this week, by the way. Thank you very much. You're welcome. Anyway, all you had to do was say, I believe in Zeus, or I believe in Hera, or whatever, whoever you guys worshipped back then, and they would have let you go. You just parrot a belief in any one of the state gods, and boom, you're free. It was a simple thing, and you didn't do it. Why?
If I had professed belief in one of the official gods, I would have offended the very God I could not name. You see, this unknown God gave me my vocation to philosophy.
You mean the God who spoke to you through the Delphic Oracle?
Yes. He called me. He seemed to set me aside from all the other Greeks, and he told me that I was the wisest man in the world because of my ignorance. Or rather, my knowledge of my ignorance. You see, all other men thought they had wisdom. I knew I had none. Thus, I was wiser than they. But it was obvious to me then, and it's even more obvious to me here and now, that those who claim to know the most actually know the least, especially about the gods. And so I tried to enlighten them, but then they began to hate me.
Really? Why don't you enlighten us here? Enlighten us now. We promise not to hate you. At least we'll try not to.
Now, Socrates, we won't hate you in the least. We of the modern world, we're very open-minded.
But an open mind exists to be shut around an idea that is true. And some of you have some difficulty with true ideas these days, don't you?
Be that as it may, you have yet to tell us what you thought of the Bible. First of the Hebrew scriptures, and then please tell us about the New Testament.
All right. The Hebrew scriptures first.
Yes.
As I say, I was not entirely surprised at their notion that there was one God. We had what you might call a premonition about that, even in Athens. But to think that this one God made everything out of nothing? That is astonishing.
Wait a second. All cultures have creation myths. The Greek gods created and ran the universe.
Thomas, our gods simply shaped or molded the world out of stuff that was already there. But to think that the single unitary God made everything out of nothing, that astonished me, and that came at the very beginning. And then, not only that, to think that the single unitary perfect God was a person, that he had a will or what you might call a personality. Even that's astonishing. For instance, the God of the Jews loved. He loved his creation. He loved his people. He loved them so much that he gave them a series of ethical laws to follow, which they loved, though they had difficulty following them. The whole thing was a relationship of love. And yet, love exists in time. Love is a process. Young people realize that. And yet, how can a God who is both outside of time and the creator of time operate in a process in time? And yet that apparent contradiction prepared me to a certain extent, as it must have prepared the Jews for the ultimate surprise of what you call the incarnation.
Wait. Now you're moving ahead. I want to hear more about the Jewish God, God the Father, Yahweh. What else did you learn about him?
His goodness, for one thing. I had always known that the true God would be perfectly good, but the goodness of the God of the Jews seems somehow related to the goodness of the deeds he commands us to perform. Be ye holy, as I, the Lord your God, am holy, as he tells his people in the book of Leviticus.
Why do you see the importance of that point?
It meant that I was right and Euthyphro was wrong. Euthyphro said that a thing is good because God wills it. I said God wills it because it is good, and yet I failed to see that a thing is good only insofar as it resembles God.
What else surprised you about God?
Yes, his name, Professor. When he speaks to Moses out of the burning bush and tells us his name, he says, it is I am, or I am that I am. That name seemed very special to me.
Yes, you're right. It's the sacred tetragrammaton, the name no Jew will ever pronounce.
Because when he's telling us his name, he's telling us his identity, his nature. He is being itself, am, as well as personhood, I am. That revelation to Moses was utterly unique and unpredictable.
Well, then answer me this, Socrates, since you've learned so much about the Bible. Why is it that this unique notion, this name for God, was revealed to no one else but Moses? How is it that he's the only one who came up with it,
Did you not read the scriptures, Professor? Professor, Moses did not come up with it. Moses came up to it. The name of God was not Moses' idea, it was God's idea. That is why I could never name God. That is why, despite all of my years of thinking and praying, I could never name God. I had to come up to it, not come up with it. I had to receive the truth as a gift, like Moses, like Job. And yet, I never did.
So God did not give it to you?
God gave his secret to none of the Greeks. How odd of God to choose the Jews.
Ewer said that. Have you read him?
Ewer? Yeah. No, I have not read him, but when two men speak the same truth, they need not be thought to have copied from one another, but from the truth itself.
But the truth, as I said.
Then there is the question of the sinfulness of man, particularly in light of the righteousness of God. Your book is very clear. Man is a sinner, badly in need of redemption.
Socrates, we should have had you read more modern articles and not just the Bible. We don't believe in sin. Now, I'm starving. Do you mind if I grab my candy bar? I didn't have a chance to get lunch.
But please,
bring enough
Molly,
to share.
Molly, not for you.
Molly, the whole point of the incarnation was the atonement for sin.
Socrates, look. Not only are you very, very old, but you're very, very old-fashioned. Sin is one of those doctrines we just don't swallow anymore. It's a mythical, mystical belief.
On the contrary, I think it is the one teaching you can prove merely by looking around you. Man is not what he should be. All people of all ages have known that. How can you close your eyes to the reality of what the Jews call sin?
Well, imperfection maybe, but sin?
This is chocolate.
Chocolate?
Mm-hmm.
This is delicious.
Yeah.
We had nothing like this in Athens. Perhaps I was wrong about progress.
Yeah, but it's bad for you.
Bad for you?
Oh, yeah, it makes you fat.
Fat is bad? We thought fat was good, a sign of beauty.
No, science has taught us that fat is bad for you. Bad for your heart, your blood, lots of things.
Then why do you eat that?
Because it's so sweet.
But sweetness is a good.
Yes.
Or an apparent good.
Oh, yes.
Or a lesser good.
Yes.
But is not that the definition of sin? The choice of an apparent good over a real one, or a lesser good over a greater one?
Look, Socrates, I've already told you, I don't believe in sin. And if eating chocolate is a sin, it's a little sin. No big deal. Now, lying, cheating, mooching off your parents, being proud to be a slacker, leading a girl on and not calling her when you say you're gonna call her, Those, Socrates, are very big sins.
Hey, come on. I said I was sorry.
This isn't about you. You think everything's about you.
The hell I do. And speaking of which, Socrates, why didn't you just go straight to hell? I mean, why didn't you jump to that first? That little image from Scripture, twist your toga, endless suffering, eternal punishment for sin, you like that?
You object to hell.
Hell yes. I mean, heck yes. I mean, it's a horrible, outmoded belief.
But is it true?
What?
It's a simple question. Is it true? Why are you shocked?
I'll answer that question, Socrates, since Thomas can't. No, hell is not true. It's a fable. It doesn't exist.
How do you know that?
Well, because I believe God is loving and forgiving.
Forgiving of what?
Sin.
I thought you said you did not believe in sin.
Well, I believe that God is loving and forgiving.
And therefore he is not just and punishing?
Yes. I mean, no. I mean, I don't know about that therefore, but I know what you're going to say, that it doesn't logically follow that from God's mercy is he not also just?
And when I had said that, Molly, then what would you have said in reply?
Look, Socrates, if you keep this up, I will just have the conversation with myself, and I won't need you anymore.
And that is exactly my function, to make myself dispensable.
All I can say for certain is, I don't know.
Ah. Well then, we are perhaps making progress.
The admission of ignorance is the beginning of all wisdom. So, Molly, on behalf of this august university, welcome to ignorance.
Why, thank you, Thomas. Now you won't feel so alone.
Hey, wait a minute.
No, you see, your scriptures say something a bit different. They say again and again that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. So my question is, how are we to fear a God who neither judges nor punishes us?
Socrates, look, if we've learned anything, it's this. If there is a God and there isn't, if he is anything and he isn't, he's not to be feared.
How do you know that?
Well, we know that he's merciful because the New Testament insists upon it.
But the New Testament also insists that he is just and punishing and that hell is real.
Well, I reject that.
Molly, on what basis do you reject some teachings of Scripture but accept others?
I'm just interpreting Scripture in light of my own convictions.
But Molly, certainly you should interpret any book or the opinions of any person not in light of your convictions but of theirs.
Well, I never thought...
Listen, Socrates, I got something for you here, okay? Those fires of hell and the images of darkness and stuff in the New Testament, they're just that. Images, not to be taken literally. Metaphors.
The parable of the prodigal son, is that to be taken literally?
No, it's a parable.
A parable that teaches that God is merciful and forgiving.
Yeah.
So why do you accept the lesson of the one parable, the prodigal son, which teaches that God is merciful and forgiving, but reject the lesson of the other parable, hell, which teaches that he's just and punishing?
I see. Okay. Oh, hey, got it. Boom. All right. Chew on this, okay? Here, look, you're a logical dude, right, Socrates? Here, have a seat.
Yes.
I mean, you're going to have to make it into a chair again first, but... All right? Let me break this down for you, old school, or, like, maybe new school for you. Okay, so, logical. God of the Jews. Perfect, right?
Right.
Boom, okay. How can God be perfectly just and punishing and perfectly merciful and forgiving? Boom! Nailed it.
I have a question. How can God be both a still small voice and also an earthquake?
Exactly.
Oh, I'm so glad we got here. You see, now you know why this school exists, the fallacy of Christian belief, Socrates. Christian belief is an entire fallacy. Why, think about this. If you keep up this kind of thinking, you'll be an MDiv.
An MDiv?
Master of Divinity.
Good heavens, no, Professor. I could never enslave that which is superior to me.
Socrates, the point is, Christianity is rife with contradictions. It makes no logical sense.
Maybe it does.
It doesn't.
These are all apparent contradictions, but there is one way that they all come together.
And what is that?
Molly told us last week. Love. Love can be both merciful and forgiving and just and punishing. Does not love have eyes? Does not love make choices? Is not love both a still small voice and also an earthquake?
Earthquakes, judgment, hellfire. Look, Socrates, I don't know what God you believe in, but I prefer a God of peace.
Molly, this is not a question of what you prefer, but of what is true.
I thought the question was what God I choose to believe in.
Molly, do you choose your gods the way you do your candy bars?
Molly.
Well, of course not.
Listen, look, Socrates has a point, right? I mean, he's right. Love can be upset sometimes. You know, maybe love gets jealous that you start hanging out with a guy who's twice your age and stop giving me the time of day. Or anybody the time of day, whatever.
Jealous. You said you were drunk.
Well, I was drunk. That doesn't mean I'm not jealous, too. Yeah, anybody could be jealous
really?
Of whatever.
Okay. Let's get back on track, shall we?
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Socrates, you said when you came in here that you had one question for us. And yet it seems as if you've asked us about 100 questions each.
My apologies.
Please, your one apology was more than enough.
I still have one big question that remains unanswered for you. What did you make of the New Testament? Remember, what did you make of Jesus? I believe that's what this class is supposed to be about. What did you learn?
I learned why I was brought to life. In your day, it was to meet someone who was born 400 years after I died.
Jesus of Nazareth, of course.
Yes.
And you claim you met the real Jesus, just as we are meeting the real Socrates.
Yes, Professor. I did.
You know, I think it's remarkable what a little bit of psychodrama can affect. Yes. A bit of well-played pretense really can be instructive.
I think it's even more remarkable what a real life person can affect.
All right.
I am no pretense, Professor, and neither is Jesus.
The identity of both of you is certainly in question.
Well, to you, maybe, but not to me.
All right, answer me this. What exactly do you mean when you say you met him?
I mean that I met something more than a pretense, just as you are meeting something more than a pretense of Socrates.
Just as I see. Very clever, Socrates.
No, Professor, you're wrong on both counts.
What do you mean?
You do not see, and I am not very clever.
Do you claim to have had a mystical experience? Is that what this is about?
Professor, I claim to have met a person. Is that a mystical experience? You and I have met. We met last week. Was our meeting a mystical experience?
From where I was standing, it looked like love at first sight.
What a line.
Come on. Don't get personal.
Oh, yeah. Well,
you two, enough.
One.
Sit down.
Sorry.
Now look.
Yes.
Socrates, or whoever you are, when you and I met last week, for whoever you are, whatever you are a person. But when you read the New Testament, you did not meet a person. You merely read a book.
I did not merely read a book, Professor. The book was not the object of my experience, but the medium or occasion.
Like a sacrament.
A what?
Catholic thing. Part of my past. Forget about it. Doesn't matter.
You have a past?
It's clear I don't have a future, at least with you.
So let me get this straight. Thomas Keptic has a personal history. I wonder if historical Tom is anything like historical Jesus. A riddle men twist to their own ends.
Sure, men deny my true purpose in life all the time.
And so do you. And you know what? I'm not okay with that. Because if you would do something with yourself, maybe you would see you do have a future, even with me.
Do we have permission to move on? Are you done? Yep.
I grant it,
Thank
sir.
Thank you very much. Now, I want to follow up on something one of you said, however. One of you said that men twist their interpretation of the historical Jesus in order to suit their own ends. Mm-hmm. Yes, let's follow up on that. For it seems to me, Socrates, that this is the essence of organized religion. What have you to say to that?
Well, I have no doubt that people would twist this Jesus to suit their own ends, but this book is very clear about who he is and what those ends were. To this end was I born, and for this cause came I into the world, as he tells Pontius Pilate, that I might bear witness to the truth. Everyone who is of the truth hears my voice. You are professors and students. Are you not of the truth? Do you not hear his voice? Does it not stir you in your heart and in your very soul?
I'm not sure I follow you, Socrates. Are you upset, perhaps, that we're not all saints?
Well, no. The people in this book are hardly heroes of perfection. They're nothing like the heroes of the literature and mythology of my day, which is why this book seems so real to me. But that's not what I'm trying to say, Professor. What I'm trying to say is when I read about this Jesus and his called out ones, which is what the word church means,
yes,
I find something so strong, so distinctive, so full of life and love that it is like the noonday sun. It's no wonder that this Christianity thing turned the whole world upside down. Even the hard-nosed Roman world. It's no wonder that the people who met Jesus either worshipped him or crucified him. It's no wonder that the people who met his apostles either believed them and worshipped him or didn't believe them and persecuted them for telling this abominable, insane lie. That is what I am trying to say, Professor. According to this book, it's all or nothing. Either or.
So you're defending fanaticism, that's it.
No, not fanaticism.
Then what?
Something more like marriage. Fidelity. In loveness. That is something I think I should be seeing in the Christians around me, but that is not something I see.
What do you think you see around you instead?
Scholarship! Teachers and students playing at a game, like children playing at safari, when there is a real lion lurking in their own front yards. That's what I see. And casual dress, casual attitudes, casual faith, casual worship. Your atheism is strident, but your faith is casual. Casual this, casual that, and from what I can tell, a great deal of casual sex. Why are you not lovers and warriors for what you love? Your book condemns fornication, but passion and jealousy would redeem some of your sin. It would make it more than lust. It's not even lust. From what I can tell by looking at these young people around me, it's more like boredom. Is this why God came into the world? Is this why he died on a cross? Is this why he rose from the grave? His apostles knew he did all those things. And if he rose and was alive then, he is still alive now. But you're not treating him as if he were alive. He's alive like an animal, more alive than an animal. How are you treating him? How are you treating him? You're treating him as if he were a picture on a wall or a bump on a log. Did you ever sit down on a bump on a log and find out it was a frog? Or maybe the whole log was an alligator. Look out, you say, it's alive. But I haven't seen anyone say anything like that here.
So if I'm understanding this right, you saw the alligator?
Molly, isn't that what happened to you? Didn't the alligator come to life?
Well, in a sense.
Molly, I began with one question, and I'm going to end with one question. Do you believe Christ rose from the tomb?
Well, in a sense.
In what sense?
Oh, resurrection is an archetype, a symbol, you know, a Platonic idea. Everything rises from the dead. Jesus stands for life. Life is the most important thing, and that is why Easter comes in the springtime, when the world is filled with new life, and that's why we have Easter eggs and Easter bunnies. Because they're all symbols of a new life.
Molly, if I understand your Bible correctly, you have it exactly backwards.
Backwards? What do you mean?
From your book's perspective. Easter cannot be said to come at springtime. Rather, spring comes at Easter time. According to that book, Jesus is the source and summit of all life, and all life depends on him.
Socrates.
Professor, Lord. I have a question to ask you. Do you believe Christ rose from the tomb? A simple question, Professor.
Socrates, I really believe you're missing the point. Now,
Professor, I really don't believe you're answering my question. Do you believe Christ rose from the tomb?
Socrates. There was a professor named Bultmann who said that even if the bones of the dead Jesus were found in a tomb in Palestine tomorrow, even if it were proven that the resurrection had never taken place, all of the essentials of Christianity would still remain unchanged. You, my friend, are ignoring those essentials.
That's what Bultmann said?
That's what Bultmann says.
It's not what this book says. If Christ be not raised, then is our faith in vain. That does not sound like all of the essentials unchanged to me.
It was a resurrection of the Spirit.
Molly's right. It was the joy of the disciples in discovering their shared faith.
Mm-hmm. For which they were persecuted, tortured, executed. If I had said I believe in one of the official gods, I would have been spared my execution. If they had said he is alive, but in spirit only, they would have been spared there. But they did not say that any more than I did. They knew that he rose bodily from the tomb and that he is with you bodily today.
Oh, really? Tell me, where is this body?
The book tells us. It's in the church he established on earth. And it's in heaven where he sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead.
The charade is up. I've had enough of this. You're a dogmatist. You play a good Socrates, but Socrates would never have been a dogmatist.
No, Professor,
go, Miss Cottle. Now, I will allow anything for the sake of learning, but I will not allow the Nicene Creed.
The what?
And that's another thing. Explain this to me. All you've read is the Bible, correct?
Yes.
Then how is it that you quote from a creed only formulated 4 centuries after the death of Jesus? How do you quote from it just now? Explain that one.
I had no idea I was quoting from any creed, but as I said earlier, if two men speak the same truth, they need not be thought to have copied from one another, but from the truth itself.
Oh, truth. Smooth! I've had it with you, mister. Now you get out of here before I call security. Your posing is over. Get out!
Yes, I'm sorry.
Get...
Professor, I'm leaving. You do not need to get excited. This is not the first time I have caught trouble for speaking the truth.
Oh, there's that word again. Out!
Professor,
out!
Professor, I'm leaving. Professor, I will go. But I want to ask one last question. I want to present the question to our resident skeptic Thomas. One final question, and then... The time of my departure has come, as I said in my apology.
You mean, as St. Paul said in his epistle to Timothy?
Well, yes, that's right. 500 years after I did, the pervasive influence of truth.
Socrates?
I'm sorry, I won't say that word again.
Go on.
Thank you, Professor. Thomas, do you believe Christ rose from the tomb?
Of course he doesn't. He's an atheist.
Mm-hmm. Huh. My mom always answers questions for my dad, too. Must be love.
Tom.
Molly.
Socrates.
Tom. Do you believe Christ rose from the tomb?
Let's take a walk, old man. Let's take a walk and talk about the love of truth. Oh, sorry, Professor, I know you hate that word. Love of wisdom. Man, that's better. Hey, that's kind of got a ring to it. Love of wisdom. What's that in Greek?
Love of wisdom in Greek. Philosophy.
Philosophy. Amen.
Oh, Tom, wait, Tom, you forgot your books.
Socrates, I don't think he wants his books. I think he wants what you had, an encounter with a person.
Oh. Well, then maybe you should take them to him.
I'm okay with that.
Well, that, Professor, is what we call a resurrection of the spirit. Thank you.
Where are you going now?
Wherever the gods send me. Correction, my friend. Wherever God sends me. Thank you.
Socrates, come back to life. A miracle. The Habit School of Divinity finds Jesus. Another miracle. Professor Nuance repents and is saved. Another miracle. But that last one will never happen. Mm-mm. Although, I begin to suspect a self-referential inconsistency in my hermeneutic. I need another one of these.